This week on Jerusalem Dateline, we'll show you some of the most amazing discoveries of recent years, from King David's Palace to Solomon's Temple, and the places where some of the most famous prophets of the Bible worked and lived. How archaeology is confirming the history of the Bible, bringing its characters to life. Welcome to this special edition of Jerusalem Dateline.
It seems like almost every day, archaeologists are making new discoveries. Many of them date back to biblical times and shed light on the people and places in the scriptures. Not too long ago, a discovery was made about the existence of ancient Israel's most famous leader, King David. Julie Stahl has more.
This is Herbat Kaifa in the Elah Valley. Not far from here, the Bible says David killed the giant Goliath.
We don't know much about the history, the politics really, and about urbanization in the time of David. From the Bible, we don't know it. And here in Herbat Kaifa, for the first time, we have a fortified city from the time of King David.
About 20 miles outside Jerusalem, Herbat Kaifa was a border city in the Kingdom of Judah, not too far from Goliath's hometown of Gath. Carbon dating shows it existed from 1020 to 980 BC, about the time of King David. Hebrew University archaeologist Yosef Garfinkel worked together with the Israel Antiquities Authority. He says they excavated dozens of rooms. He believes three of them were used for religious purposes.
The infrastructure is different. You have isolated rooms in building, while in Canaanite and pagan, as you said, you have real temples.
But that's not all. Garfinkel presented these religious artifacts at a press conference in Jerusalem.
We have two boxes, these artifacts that you see here. One made of pottery and the other made from stone, and they were used for keeping symbols of God.
The portable shrines were shaped like temples and confirmed the biblical description found in 1 Kings. That describes the architectural style in Solomon's temple and shows that the style existed even before Solomon. The site contained no statues or pig bones. That means the people who lived there followed the biblical commandments not to eat pork or keep graven images, unlike their Canaanite or Philistine neighbors. Earlier, archaeologists also found the oldest Hebrew inscription at the site.
Okay, so the ethnicity of the city is like Judah.
So why are these discoveries important? Garfinkel says it disproves the argument of some scholars who say the Bible was written 800 years after King David, with no connection to real history.
And this is, I think, the strength of our argument, that we have historical memories embedded in the Hebrew Bible, and people cannot say that David and Solomon are mythological figures. They were actually human beings.
Garfinkel says the Bible and archaeology have to work together. Julie Stahl, CBN News, Herbat Kaifa, Israel.
Have you ever wanted to step back 3,000 years into the pages of the Bible? Now, visitors at a new site in Jerusalem can do just that.
For the first time in modern history, this unique ancient site has been open to the public.
Beginning today, people will be able to actually walk through First Temple period remains, touch the stones, enjoy and study about yet another period of the archaeology of the city of Jerusalem.
3,000 years ago, stonemasons built these walls to protect the city of Jerusalem. Archaeological evidence indicates that the one who commissioned and oversaw this construction was King Solomon.
The reality was that a very highly skilled fortification and a sophisticated fortification was built by King Solomon. And this is only part of it. And it's very impressive. Mm. And you saw this wall, huge stone and so on. And it continues.
Archaeologist Elat Mazar uncovered the site, called the Ophel, just below Jerusalem's Temple Mount, restored it, and told her story in the book, Discovering the Solomonic Wall in Jerusalem. Mazar believes the Bible refers to this area in the first book of Kings. It says, until he, King Solomon, had made an end of building his own house and the house of the Lord and the wall of Jerusalem round about.
Lots of it is really can be seen and can be touched. And we find lots of stuff that really go directly into the biblical sources.
Other tangible examples include this floor that Mazar believes was part of a royal building destroyed in 586 BC when the Babylonians conquered Jerusalem. The excavation also exposed the structure called the Gatehouse that would have looked like this 3,000 years ago. Jerusalem Mayor Nir Barkat sees the site as not only a great piece of history, but as another way to share the magic of the old city.
One of the best investments in the future is exposing our past. It enables people to come and see that it's real, come and visit, and go back home as ambassadors of peace. It shows that the Bible is real. It shows that 2,000 and 3,000 years ago, Jerusalem was the center of the world.
Archaeology deals with centuries and millennia, but the news still goes on. To find out what's happening in the Middle East and Israel now, here's our weekly news wrap-up.
Thanks, Chris, and hello, everyone. Welcome to this Jerusalem Dateline weekly news wrap. I'm Ephraim Graham. The Fatah political party is praising the Palestinian terrorists who drove into a Jerusalem crowd, killing a three-month-old baby before police killed him. Fatah is the party of Palestinian leader Mahmoud Abbas. The group posted a picture of the killer on its Facebook page, calling him a martyr for killing, quote, settlers in the occupied city of Jerusalem. CBN Middle East correspondent Julie Stahl has the story.
Wednesday's terror attack was captured by a security camera that showed Abdel Rahman al-Shaluti driving off the road and accelerating as he ran over pedestrians waiting for a train. Three-month-old Haya Zissel Brown, an American citizen, was killed and seven others wounded in the attack. Haya's grandfather told reporters her parents had tried for years to have a child and had just returned from the Western Wall. She was buried overnight in Jerusalem. Shaluti, the terrorist, was from the mostly Arab neighborhood of Silwan, also known as the City of David, the original site of biblical Jerusalem.
The suspect fled the scene. He was shot by police units that responded quickly in the area. And obviously we're looking at this incident at this moment in time as a strong possibility of a terrorist-related incident.
Recently, a number of Jewish families moved into Silwan, sparking protests there. Media reports said Hamas carried out the attack.
The attack on a mother and baby is typical of Hamas, President Abbas's partner in the Palestinian government. President Abbas himself, unfortunately, continues to use inflammatory rhetoric, inciting against Israelis. This instead of being a force for peace and reconciliation.
For months, Palestinians have mounted a campaign of stone throwing at Israelis in eastern sections of Jerusalem, which they want for a capital of a future state. On his Facebook page, Defense Minister Moshe Ya'alon said, "The Israeli-Palestinian conflict is not about territory, but about Palestinian refusal to recognize Israel as a Jewish state." Julie Stahl, CBN News, Jerusalem.
A Pakistani court is upholding the death sentence for Asia Bibi, the Christian woman accused of blaspheming the Prophet Muhammad. Bibi, a 50-year-old mother of five, was sentenced in 2010. Although the appeals court rejected Bibi's appeal, her attorneys vowed to take it to Pakistan's Supreme Court. Bibi's case drew global attention in 2011 when two politicians were killed for supporting her. Over the years, various international human rights organizations have called for her release. Amnesty International said Bibi's sentence is a grave injustice. With Christians facing severe attacks from ISIS and other Muslims in the Middle East, Jews are now joining forces with Christians to fight the growing persecution of believers in Islamic countries. Chris Mitchell has that story.
When hundreds of thousands of Christians, men, women, and children are killed, this isn't a war. This is genocide. And Jews know what happens when the world is silent to genocide.
As head of the World Jewish Congress, Ron Lauder advocates for Jewish people around the world. Now he's teaming up with the International Christian Embassy Jerusalem and Empowered 21 to fight Christian persecution.
What's happened to the Christians? They're being massacred and killed. Some like 120,000 were killed last year, and no one says anything. Everyone is focusing on Gaza.
The World Jewish Congress, Empowered 21, and the International Christian Embassy Jerusalem sent a letter recently to more than 100 world leaders, calling on them to take up the cause of persecuted Christians in Muslim countries. Together, these three groups represent millions around the world.
For the first time, to my knowledge, in modern history, probably even in the history of Jewish-Christian relations, a Jewish organization and a Christian organization are joining in a letter to protect Christians in the Middle East.
There has simply been a horrendous thing that has been going on. Christianity is dwindling in the Middle East, and we believe it should be growing.
Canon Andrew White, known as the Vicar of Baghdad, told of ISIS persecuting Christians in Iraq.
The children said, "We have always followed Yeshua. We will never leave Yeshua." They all had their heads chopped off. This is the kind of terror that we are facing.
Lauder encouraged more than 4,000 Christians from 80 nations at the Feast of Tabernacles celebration to fight together.
In Paul's second letter to Timothy, he wrote, "God did not give us the spirit of fear, but the spirit of power. Do not fear, have courage, have strength, and as one, Christians and Jews, we will be strengthened together, and we will not fail." Shalom.
Coming up, we continue our trip through archaeology in the Holy Land, including a dig 15 years in the making and the discovery that makes it all worthwhile.
Welcome back to this special edition of Jerusalem Dateline. He healed the sick, raised the dead, and called down fire from heaven. The prophet Elijah was one of the great figures of the Bible. Here's an exclusive look at a site that may contain his house.
This is Tel Rahov in the Jordan Valley. During 16 years of digging, archaeologists uncovered a 3,000-year-old, well-planned city. They also found a unique building that might have been the house of Elisha.
The house was full with objects of unique type. Two altars we found there, two pottery altars that were used for burning incense.
Lead archaeologist Ami Mazar also points out the difference in the structure of the house.
Normally houses have one entrance leading into a large space with rooms all around. This house was divided into two wings. The two wings were connected to one another through the back room. And each one of the wings had an opening towards the street.
Outside the room were incense altars, maybe used to make an offering to God before entering to hear the prophet's message.
During the excavation, archaeologists discovered this special room inside the house with a table and a bench inside. They also discovered a pottery shard with the name Elisha on it, dated to the 9th century, which leads some to believe this was the room of the prophet Elisha.
We found an ink inscription written in red ink on pottery. It's broken, unfortunately, but we reconstruct the name as Elisha.
Elisha was born about 7 miles from Tel Rahov in Avel Mahola and went throughout the kingdom of Israel, from Jericho to Samaria to Shunam.
I cannot say for sure that this particular Elisha that we found is the biblical Elisha. You know, it's very difficult to say. But it's very tempting because it's exactly the period when Elisha acted, the second half of the 9th century BC.
Elisha, the prophet, was known for telling the widow to borrow empty pots, fill them with a tiny cruse of oil, and sell them to pay her creditors, raising the Shunammite son from the dead, and instructing the Syrian army commander Naaman to wash in the Jordan River 7 times to be healed of leprosy. Archaeologist Stephen Fawn calls the evidence compelling.
With only 6 other people by the name of Elisha known in that time for a couple of centuries on either side, we can somehow believe that either there was just the luck that this holy man was also by the name of Elisha, or this was Elisha the prophet himself.
Another discovery pointing to Elisha is the discovery of 2 different inscriptions mentioning the family of Nimshi.
Remember, it was Elijah that was told to anoint Jehu, the son of Nimshi, to be king. He passed that on to Elisha, who sent out one of his disciples to finally do the anointing.
Many archaeologists shy away from drawing conclusions about the Bible, but some see it as a way of putting the pieces together.
Archaeology is like a huge puzzle, you know. We add information from one excavation, a second excavation, a third excavation, Chatzor, Megiddo, Tel Rehov, Beit She'an, Samaria, and together we bring it in into a large picture, the large puzzle, trying to decipher the material culture of the Israelites.
For Carrie Summers, who heads Nazareth Village, it's even more.
It's like any other archaeological site, in essence, is every scoop of dirt proves the Bible one scoop at a time, and this site is absolutely magnificent.
The future of the site is uncertain because its mud bricks are deteriorating. Experts hope, however, it can be preserved to help future generations understand the Bible. Coming up, we take you to an ancient church scientists believe marks the burial site of the prophet Zechariah. In early Christian history, when church leaders thought they had found a historical biblical site, they often built a church to mark the spot. Julie Stahl takes us to an ancient church where scientists believe might mark the burial site of the prophet Zechariah.
The 1,500-year-old church is situated in the Judean hills about 20 miles from Jerusalem. Archaeologists discovered it after Palestinian looters, searching for treasures to sell, damaged the surface of the site.
In order to prevent and to salvage whatever archaeological finds were here, the Israel Antiquities Authority decided to start excavating, and the results were fantastic.
Archaeologist Shai Bartura says what's special about the church is how well it has been preserved.
The best way to see this is by looking at the mosaic floor, which is a magnificent mosaic floor. The southern hall is the one best preserved, and you can see there intricate geometrical designs. You can see wonderful wild scenes with wild animals, such as fish swimming in a pond. There's another spectacular scene of a lion hunting a gazelle.
Marble columns imported from Turkey lined the central hall of the basilica.
We're trying to figure out why such a magnificent building was built here.
One theory goes back to Bible times. This part of the church was built over an ancient tomb. Archaeologists say it could be the tomb of the prophet Zechariah, and the church was placed here as a memorial. Remains of the church are the only things visible on the surface now, but archaeologists say Jewish villages existed here during the Second Temple period and hundreds of years later during the Great Jewish Revolt against the Romans. Jews of that day built a system of tunnels and caves under this hill for living and as a means of escape. Experts speculate an earthquake in the 8th century destroyed the church.
One of the most wonderful things about archaeology, and especially about sites like these, is the visitor coming to this church, uncovered now, basically walks into the same building and sees the same thing that the Christian worshippers would have seen 1,500 years ago.
The Israel Antiquities Authority plans to eventually open the site to the public. In the meantime, it will be covered up with sand and layers of fabric in order to preserve it from decay. Julie Stahl, CBN News, Kirbet Midras.
If you'd like to learn more, visit our History and Archaeology page on Facebook. You can find links to stories on the history of the church. Even check out ongoing archaeological digs. We'll be right back. Our final story doesn't have much to do with archaeology, which is history buried in the ground, but this is living history and an opportunity for visitors to see up close and personal some of the animals found in the scriptures. Because in Jerusalem, even the zoo has a biblical theme.
Did you know that monkeys were among the treasures the ships of Tarshish brought to King Solomon every 3 years? That little-known fact and many others come to life at the Tisch Family Zoological Gardens, known to many as the Biblical Zoo. Some 700,000 visitors a year also learn there is more to animal life in Israel than camels and sheep.
Free afternoon. We want to enjoy the zoo. It's a beautiful zoo. We came to see the animals, right?
Not far from busy Jerusalem streets, this 60-acre Biblical Zoo is home to more than 1,000 animals. Many of them are native to Israel. Others have become extinct over the years, but the zoo is bringing them back to their native land. That includes animals fought by a young shepherd named David. The Syrian brown bear, which lived in northern Israel, hasn't existed here for more than 100 years. Lions no longer prowl the hills of Israel, but at one time their presence was commonplace.
We think that the Asian lion is the lion that roamed the land of Israel more than 800 years ago, mentioned in the Bible, of course, and is also the symbol of Jerusalem and the tribe of Judah.
They took the trunks and wrapped it around another elephant's tail.
Although elephants are not found in the Bible, ivory is mentioned several times as a precious commodity.
What do you like about the giraffe?
But the giraffe is a tree.
Yeah?
It's way bigger than this.
Some Jewish sages believed the mountain sheep was actually a giraffe, and the behemoth of Job is thought to be a hippopotamus. In the Bible Land Preserve, you can see animals of the Bible roaming freely in an area like their natural habitat, like the Nubian ibex, referred to as a wild goat in the Bible. The horns of the male can grow more than 50 inches long and served as shofars or ceremonial horns in the ancient Jewish temple. Other animals, like the Persian fallow deer, were totally extinct in Israel.
Today, thanks to a special breeding program, you can actually see them in many parts of Israel in nature.
There's a Noah's Ark Visitor Center designed to capture the biblical concept of preserving animal life.
This is one of our symbols and which connect the biblical story to the actual thing that we are doing here and now.
Yet the biblical zoo is about more than just animals. It's about coexistence in Jerusalem.
Actually, this is one of the best places to be with the children, to spend the time with the children in the afternoon in Jerusalem.
We want everybody to come and feel welcome in a place that has a common interest, which is the animals, which is nature, which is conservation.
Julie Stahl, CBN News, The Biblical Zoo, Jerusalem.
Well, that's it for this special edition of Jerusalem Dateline. If you'd like to know more, you can visit us on our Facebook page or our website at cbnnews.com. I hope you've enjoyed this trip back to biblical times. I'm Chris Mitchell. We'll see you next time on Jerusalem Dateline.